Alpha Education.
Assalamualaikum students, welcome on my YouTube channel Alpha Education. Hope you all are fine and happy in your life. So students, our today's lecture is about semantics, and the topic that we are going to discuss today is demonstrating semantic knowledge. We have discussed the five aspects of speaker semantic knowledge in the previous lecture, and I told you there are 10 aspects of semantic knowledge, but we have discussed only five in the previous lecture because the lecture was going to be so long and I have divided the lecture in two parts. So this is the second half of the previous lecture, and in this lecture we will discuss the remaining five aspects of semantic knowledge. This lecture is going to be delivered through Alpha Education. If you didn't subscribe my channel, so please do subscribe to my channel and share this lecture with your friends so that they can also get benefits from this lecture. So without wasting time, let's start our today's lecture. So I told you as earlier that there are 10 aspects of semantic knowledge, and we have discussed five of them. So the remaining five aspects of semantic knowledge are the following, in which the first one is semantic feature, the second one is ambiguity, then adjacency pair, entailment, and presupposition. So we will discuss each of the aspects of semantic knowledge one by one with example, and you will understand it very easily. So the first aspect that we are going to discuss now, that is semantic feature. So synonyms and antonyms have to have some common element of meaning in order to be respectively the same or different. As we discussed in the previous lecture, the synonymy and antonymy, we have discussed that if two words are synonym, it means they both have same meaning. And if we have discussed that if two words are antonyms, they have different meaning to each other. So here in semantic feature, we are discussing that the words synonyms and the antonyms have some common element of meaning in order to be, if they both are the synonyms, so they will have a same element of meaning, and if they both are antonyms, so they will have a different element of meaning in order to be synonym or antonym. So words can have some element of meaning without being synonymous or antonymous. As we have discussed that when two words relate with each other in respect of similarity or in respect of difference, so they become synonyms or antonyms. But here what we are going to discuss, that words can have some element of meaning without being synonymous or antonymous, that two words can relate each other without being synonym or antonym. For example, we should, like, there are examples that 6a and 6b. For example, we should all agree that in each of the following group of words, these are the group of words, the 6a group of words and the 6b group of words. For example, we should all agree that in each of the following group of words, 6a and 6b, all but one of the words have something in common, which is the word that doesn't belong. So here in the group of words 6a and in the group of words 6b, they all relate with each other except one word. And in the 6b, these all words relate with each other in some way except one. So here, street, land, road, path, house, avenue, we can see that the street relate somehow with the land, and it somehow relate with the road, and road is also somehow relate with the path, but it doesn't relate with the house. And the avenue can also be related with the other group of other words of this group. So the house does not relate with the other words, but all the other words, they are relatable in some way, and this relation called semantic feature, that there is a common element which can relate all the words in the group 6a except house. And the same case here in 6b, buy, take, use, steal, acquire, inherent. We can say that inherent, acquire, steal, take, buy, these five words can relate with each other except use, because the meaning of buy, take, steal, acquire, inherent, they all have some common element of meaning except use, because the uses have a different meaning with regards to the other members of this group. So the common element of meaning shared by all but one word in 6A and by all but one item in 6B is semantic feature. That the common element of meaning, which is shared by all the elements in the 6A group and all the elements in the 6B group except house and use, this common element of meaning is called semantic feature. So the second aspect is ambiguity. What is ambiguity? Some sentences have double meanings. They can be interpreted in two ways. That when a sentence can be interpreted in two ways and when it has two meanings, so we say that this sentence has ambiguity. Speakers are aware of this fact because they appreciate jokes which depend on two-way interpretation like the following. Like in the following sentences, the 7A and 7B examples, here we can say that the speaker are aware of the ambiguity in the sentences and that's why we appreciate jokes. The 7A example is Marjorie doesn't care for her parakeet. This sentence has two meanings. If we said that Marjorie doesn't care for her parakeet, it can mean that Marjorie doesn't like her parakeet. But in the second sense, it can also mean that Marjorie doesn't care for her parakeet. It means she's not taking care of her parakeet. In the second sentence, Marjorie took the sick parakeet to a small animal hospital. In this sentence, we can also interpret that the small hospital for animals, that Marjorie took the sick parakeet to a hospital which is for the small animals, or Marjorie took the parakeet to a small animal hospital means it is a hospital for the small animals. In the first sense, we can say it is a small hospital for animals. And in the second sense, we can say hospital for small animals. So these two sentences are ambiguous and that's why we can say this sentence has ambiguity. A sentence that has two meanings is ambiguous, an example of ambiguity. Then the third one is adjacency pair. When a question and an answer or any two utterances can go together in a conversation and the second is obviously related to the first, that they constitute an adjacency pair. That when there is a question or there is an answer or the any two utterances means when a speaker asks a question and when the second person answers the question, or like these are the two utterances, when they go together in a conversation, like the second sentence is obviously related to the first sentence, so then we say that they both constitute an adjacency pair. How? Like these are the examples. So here there are two sentences, like there are two questions and there are different answers to each of the question. The first question is, when did you last see my brother? These are the answers, possible answers. 10 minutes ago, last Tuesday, very nice, around noon, I think it was on 1st of June. The second question is, there's a great new comedy at the Old Town Playhouse. So, I have heard, what's it called? When did it open? So do I. Are you sure it's a comedy? So these are the possible answers to these both questions. But in the group of these answers, there's an answer which is most appropriate with the first question, and there is in these answers there's an answer for this question which is most appropriate with this. Thus for each question in 8A, some answers are suggested, like these are the answers which are suggested, of which all but one might be appropriate. Similarly, the statement in 8B is followed by several possible rejoinders, all but one of which could be appropriate. Like in these answers, one is more appropriate with the question, and that pair with this question called adjacency pair. Then entailment. Speakers are aware that two statements may be related in a way that if one is true, the other must also be true. Like if a person said two sentences, okay, so if there is an entailment, so we can say that if one sentence is true, like if a person utter one sentence and then another one, so if the first sentence is true, the second must also be true. Like these are the examples. The example number one, there are tulips in the garden. There are flowers in the garden. The ladder is too short to reach the roof. The ladder isn't long enough to reach the roof. So now, these pair of sentences are examples of entailment. How? Assuming that 9A and 9B are about the same garden. If the 9A and 9B are about the same garden, so we can say the sentence 9A and 9B have entailment in it. How? That these are the tulips in the garden. Tulips are the types of flowers. So we can say that there are flowers in the garden. But if we say that there are flowers in the garden, so it can also mean that there are tulips in the garden. Same is the case with the example 9C and 9D. The ladder is too short to reach the roof. The ladder isn't long enough to reach the roof. The truth of 9A entails the truth of 9B. Like if 9A is true, 9B must also be true if they both are about the same garden. And 9C will be true if 9D is also true if they both are about the same ladder. That is, 9A is true, 9B must also be true, and same is the case with likewise, assuming the same ladder and roof, the truth of 9C entails the truth of 9D. Then presupposition. Speaker know that the message conveyed in one sentence may presuppose other pieces of knowledge. For instance, these are the examples. For instance, if 10A is accepted as true, 10B, 10E must also be accepted as true. How? Like if we say that example number 10A is true, Andy Murphy usually drives his Datsun to work. If this sentence is true, so there is a person named Andy Murphy, this will also be true. Andy Murphy works, there is a Datsun that belongs to Andy Murphy, and Andy Murphy knows how to drive an automobile. So if the sentence 10A is accepted as true that Andy Murphy usually drives his Datsun to work, so it means that there is a person who is Andy Murphy. This is a presupposition, okay? And Andy Murphy know how to drive an automobile. The meaning of sentence 10A presupposes what is expressed in 10B, C, D, and E. Like these, all the remaining sentences are the presupposed sentences which depend on the sentence 10A. The latter are the presuppositions of 10A. These four sentences are the presupposition of 10A. This is today's lecture. If you learned something from the lecture, so please like the lecture, share it with your friends. Inshallah, in the next lecture, I will come up with a new lecture and with a new concept and with a new topic. So till then, take care of yourself and do subscribe to my channel and support me as much as you can. Allah Hafiz. Take care.